We interrupt this program with a special bulletin. America is now under martial law. All constitutional rights have been suspended. Stay in your homes. Do not attempt to contact loved ones, insurance agents, or attorneys. Shut up. Do not attempt to think or depression may occur. Stay in your homes. Curfew is at 7 p.m. sharp after work. Anyone caught outside the gates of their subdivision sectors after curfew will be shot. Remain calm. Do not panic. Your neighborhood watch officer will be by to collect urine samples in the morning. Anyone caught interfering with the collection of urine samples will be shot. Houses will be inspected for trace elements at noon. Anyone who fails to display the required embossed black velvet Mexican painting of Alexander Haig on their living room wall will be shot. Cameras and surveillance equipment will be posted on all lampposts and streetlights. Anyone failing to attend required worship services on Sunday will be promptly arrested and dispatched to a re-education resort. Stay in your homes. Remain calm. The number one enemy of progress is questions. National security is more important than individual will. All sports broadcasts will proceed as normal. No more than two people may gather anywhere without permission. Use only the drugs prescribed by your boss or supervisor. Shut up! Be happy. Obey all orders without question. The comfort you've demanded is now mandatory. Be happy. At last, everything is done for you. Want to talk about censorship?
Yeah! No!
Can't do that. Been censored. We have a blitz on right now. Open season on underground and dissident culture in all fronts. We have Mr. Ed Meese and his Inquisition sending an under-the-table blackmail letter to 7-Eleven and other convenience stores, if you recall, saying, take Playboy and Penthouse off your shelves or you will write you up as peddlers of pornography. Sure enough, Fear Factor worked. Chill Factor took them off the shelves. Less than a month later, do you have Walmarts here? Walmart convenience stores? Guess what they took off the shelves? Rolling Stone, Spin, Cream, and even Tiger Beat, on the grounds that these rock music publications were pornographic. And guess who ordered them to do it? Not Ed Meese, but Jimmy Swaggart. Where did a TV evangelist get so much power? This is the problem. When you start trying to shut people up, you open this Pandora's box where something as innocent on the surface as a few uptight Washington senators' wives then gives Jimmy Swaggart front page respectability when he says all rock music is pornography. And sure enough, enough dominoes fall that now we're starting to have real victims. KPFK in Los Angeles, muckraking news station, naughty word on the air, FCC decides they should go off the air. In Dallas, after a lot of pressure, a really cool underground radio station played a lot of good stuff, had their license taken away and then handed to a group from the religious right. As if Dallas didn't have enough evangelist stations already. That's what we see happening here. And now, in case you haven't heard, me and four other people are looking at a year in jail, $2,000 fine, and at least a six-week show trial coming up as early as late July over what was said with a dead Kennedy's record album. The city attorney's office in Los Angeles trumpeted these charges to the media the day before Election Day. In other words, they didn't pick Prince or Ozzy or any of the people they really want to nail. They picked somebody independent like ourselves who puts out our own records and doesn't play by the entertainment industry's rules and put airbrushed photos of our ugly face on the cover and, you know, use the standard government music ruse of like, well, you know, government music, you're only really allowed to sing about a certain set amount of things if you're going to be on a big record company. You're going to use love as a carrot on a stick. You know, everything's just going to be wonderful if suddenly you fall in love. Or wouldn't it be great and all your problems solved if you were rich? That's another one. Or for them young people who want to let off that energy, give them a safe cathartic ritual that goes nowhere, like sexist and even racist heavy metal. So people who don't play by those rules become the first targets. And so what we've been trying to do is we formed what's called the No More Censorship Defense Fund, which some of you have little newspapers there from it. You can get information that makes my short story long. You'll get a little cameo appearance by Mel and Norma Gabler of Dallas, Texas, who say that math books should be altered in our school system because when a student learns there are no absolutes, sooner or later he turns to crime and drugs. Guess who funds these people? Jerry Falwell. And guess where most school textbooks are made that go all over the country? Dallas. Maybe that's why elementary, junior high, high school textbooks have next to no mention of evolution anymore. Meanwhile, in Tennessee, did you hear about the case not far from where they had the Scopes monkey trial in Tennessee, where they ruled in favor of this group of fundamentalist Christian parents who said that The Wizard of Oz was too occult for their kid and should be taken off the shelves. Any book mentioning the Catholic Church could confuse their innocent young mind. Off the shelves it goes. Then in Alabama, a judge rules something like 118 textbooks can't be used in schools because they violate freedom of religion by not mentioning it enough for his liking. He calls it secular humanism. Guess who funded that one? Pat Robertson. And the way they sneak this into the mainstream, get it so these people get to go on TV talk shows about, oh, what about our children, is they go under the ruse of concerned parents. And nowhere is child rearing in more danger from so-called concerned parents than it is from a group of wives of right-wing congressmen, mostly Democrats, in D.C. called the Parents Music Resource Center, the PMRC. They're the ones who somehow managed to pussy-whip their husbands into holding hearings in Congress that one of them modestly called the most widely publicized media event in congressional history, saying that there's porn rock, there's occult music, we've got to get rid of it all. And the way we're going to get rid of it and bypass constitutional law so no one sues is to pressure the record companies to do it themselves in the forms of a rating system, just like movies. But this one would go further. What they were asking for was the records could be have a warning sticker slapped on them for V for violent, O for occult. Who's going to define what a cult is? How about Back in Control? Back in Control Training Center, who says the Star of David is a satanic symbol, and yet they're thanked in the back of PMRC founder Tipper Gore's book. This is where these people are coming from. Oh, for a cult. If that isn't obvious enough that these people, maybe they are a front for the religious right, if they're not their dupes, they also sent a guy to talk to Congress about wicked rock lyrics who neglected to tell the senators that he was the Reverend Jeff Ling. He says, oh yeah, I think these records should be taken completely off the shelves, and I think labeling will do that. And sure enough, it does. Some of these chain stores you see in smaller towns that are like the only record outlet in town, they're located in chain shopping malls. The malls themselves are chains. And the owners of those chain shopping malls have been sending down memos saying they will evict any store that sells any record with any warning sticker on it whatsoever. Some of these stores are located nowhere but in chain shopping malls. So their choice is blackball some heavy metal, blackball Dead Kennedys, or you can lose your lease, Jack, and go out of business. That's what this means, is behind the scenes blackballing that would never hold up in a court of law. Now, for round two, the PMRC, after going quiet for a while, they have a new media blitz coming on, right at the same time the FCC pops the radio stations, right at the same time the Immigration and Naturalization Service says that people like the Pet Shop Boys are too dangerous to come into the country. People like Hortensia Allende, whose husband Salvador was murdered by the CIA so their guy could take over Chile, she's not allowed to come and speak in this country. Nobel Prize winning author Gabriel Garcia Marquez is barred from entering this country. This is what we've got right now. We've got a blitz. And right now, at the front of the blitz, is a new alliance between the PMRC and the American Academy of Pediatrics. Children's doctors. You take your little kid into the doctor, there's going to be PMRC literature in the office. They're also allied with the PTA, whose head, Ann Kahn, encourages all 24,000 local chapters to show the PMRC slideshow prepared by the so-called research, a term I'd use loosely, by Reverend Jeff Ling. Not only that, but if you're going to have a PMRC parent saying, don't talk to your kids, let this book tell you how to raise your kids. If you're going to rely on them to decide how to raise your own kids, how can you trust somebody who won't even reveal their financial backers? Bits and pieces have come out here and there, widespread allegation that Coors beer money got them started initially and helped pay their rent. Merrill Lynch is bullish on the PMRC. Occidental Corporation. One guy from the Washington, D.C. 7-Up Bottling Company was thanked at their annual pig-picking fundraising barbecue. This book was announced as imminent in January, but it was held off until the author's husband, Senator Albert Gore Jr., announced his candidacy for president. Right as Tipper, his wife, is on TV talk shows hawking the book and keeping the name Gore in the public eye. And with Gary Hart out of the picture for getting laid in front of the Miami Herald, we might have a PMRC wife in First Lady. If you think Nancy Reagan and her drug witch hunt is bad enough, wait till you get this. Not only that, but another candidate is also married to a PMRC creature. That's Senator Paul Simon from Illinois. Another one. So what we have here is their new, more carefully disguised, moderate approach, Raising PG Kids in an X-Rated Society by Tipper Gore. Clever title. She gets the reader to assume that we're already in a PG society, or an X-rated society. Even here it says explicit material, parental advisory, which again seems like a harmless warning to put on records until you have to decide who decides what to put on what record, and then it gets booted out of the shopping malls. And big record companies are not going to let that happen. What they're going to do is what they already did to the Beastie Boys on License to Ill, called them in and said, we don't want a warning sticker. You got to take this song off and rewrite this one. And the Beastie Boys did it. That's what we're seeing now, behind the scenes. Just like with films, you know how they rate films in this country? How many of you know that the committee that rates all of our movies, R, X, PG, whatever, is totally secret? Their identities are unknown to producers, except to the head of the Motion Picture Association, Jack Valenti. Otherwise, even these big wheels, the producers, Canon Pictures, everybody, they gotta shove the film under the door to this committee, who then sends it back X, or whatever. And so they have to guess at what to cut out of the movie and then send it back X. Cut out some more. And you have to guess at to what they want cut out because you don't get to hold this committee up to any kind of accountability because they've bypassed constitutional law and they just have a secret inquisition. So what we get now is the director and producer's version of the movie goes out in Europe and a watered-down, doctored version comes out in this country. This is what they want with records, basically. Same old ruse. Concerned parents said, oh, let's see, Dead Kennedys is a Trojan horse rolling explicit violence into our homes. That's what gets me. That's how they sell these things. They say, we're just concerned parents. We don't want to censor. What about our children? Guess what charge they picked to charge me and the other people in Los Angeles? Distribution of harmful matter to minors. I mean, I wake up one morning and find that the window by my front door has been busted and there's 9 cops tearing my house apart. 3 from LA and 6 from San Francisco. All to get one guy over wicked artwork. Anyway, one's going through my phone book, another finds a Butthole Surfer's 12-inch in the kitchen. Are you involved with them, too? I mean, how many 45-year-old LAPD cops know who the Butthole Surfers are? They either have hip kids, which I tend to doubt, or they're stalking the underground. Another one came in with a slightly glazed look on his face after seeing milk carton remnants in one part of the house. And what are all those pictures of missing children doing on your kitchen wall? Do you know where they are? He later appeared on television news in San Francisco dressed in a Hawaiian shirt and shorts, saying that they needed 9 policemen to tear my house apart because it was a cooperative measure, commonplace among the police. What about our children? What they say is harmful to children is actually a painting by Swiss surrealist artist H.R. Giger, which is been displayed in galleries in America. It's in a book called 20th Century Masters of Erotic Art. You can get in many public libraries and campus libraries. But oh no, harmful to minors. So we get to be the guinea pigs. So the PMRC and this city attorney can get their name in the paper. What about our children? Tipper Gore has become so persuasive. I mean, she's actually very nice when you meet her and stuff, you know, just convert anybody there. She wrote a letter to Cream a while back. I love music. I particularly love rock and roll. The normal sex and sensuality of rock and roll is not my beef. I don't like to see them take good old rock and roll too far. The Dead Kennedys don't really have to bring it to 11-year-olds, do they? Well, they're gonna get a fight bringing it to mine. And that doesn't mean I'm an uptight prude who wants to ban rock. I grew up on rock, just like millions of my generation. But consumers and parents have rights too. I want my children to enjoy the best that rock has to offer, or else. I resent the fact that some artists and record companies cynically abuse their power over the young kids to blatantly commercialize brutality and explicit sexual references, complete with moans and groans. It particularly fosters a degrading attitude towards women. That I can agree with. But what she uses that to say is, these torture rock artists have introduced it in lyrics, visuals, live performances. These artists are guilty of smearing rock. Even liberals are beginning to get upset. Not the responsible rockers and music lovers who are also parents and feel responsible for the nurturing of children. These are demographic facts. But everyone can do their own thing. So let's keep the hardcore stuff away from the kids. The industry should help. This will enhance individual freedom of choice. And by the way, I never use hairspray. I prefer to be natural. And thanks. So I wrote her back. Dear Tipper Gore, PMRC and Cream readers, on the surface, your letter justifying your campaign to censor rock was surprisingly convincing. I'd almost be ready to fall for your concerned mommy act if it weren't for what your group says they really have in mind. I mean, guess who publishes Tipper's book here? This is the wholesale catalog from Abingdon Press, located in Nashville, Tennessee. Page one, you have Tipper's book. Page two, Tipper's book again. Then we get Evangelicals in America. Who they are, what they believe. Guess what the slogan is of Abingdon Press? America's first name in religious publishing. This person's husband is running as a liberal for president, keep in mind. Other titles include Spiritual Harvest, The Birth of God. Oh, here we are. Sacred Chow, the ultimate guide to potluck dinners. Another title we have here is Jesus Never Said Everyone Was Lovable. And every other title in this catalog is directly for the religious market except one book, which on the surface doesn't appear to be. Anyway, where were we? If the PMRC doesn't want to censor, why do its own handouts call for, this is a quote now, reassessment of contracts of artists who do things on stage the PMRC doesn't happen to approve of? This isn't just censorship, ma'am, it's blackballing. Who defines what a cult is when records get raided? Tipper Gore or Jimmy Swaggart? Your witch hunt has now damaged the lives of real victims. Me and four other people now face up to a year in jail and a $2,000 fine over what dead Kennedys say with their records. Item, the record store that sold the record to the kid in my court case was not charged. City attorney says, well, they were cooperative and took dead Kennedys off the shelves. Not just the Frankenchrist album that got charged, they took everything we ever made off all of their shelves and never brought it back again. That sound like blackballing, chilling effect? The climate you and Mr. Ed helped create made it lucrative for these charges to be filed in Los Angeles the day before Election Day. The LA City Attorney's Office says they picked us to prosecute because it was, quote, cost-effective, unquote. In other words, we are under arrest because we run our own record company, are therefore the easiest to bankrupt. I do agree that too much of today's music does blatantly commercialize brutality and fosters a degrading attitude towards women. That's funny. So does Rambo. So does almost everything on primetime TV, especially the commercials. But let's face it, Motley Crue and Judas Priest are just our generation's Bing Crosby and Bob Hope. Skilled vaudeville comedians who know how to play it safe to make a buck. Sure, they're corny, but does that mean they should be censored? I mean, who encourages more kids to wind up dead? Ozzy Osbourne or military recruiting ads? And why? Why is country western spared from your war on words? I've heard lots of whiskey-drenched honky-tonk tunes that glorify people with guns that beat their wives. Or is country protected because your husband's a senator from Tennessee and must respect the powers down in Nashville? Come on, do you really think taking away a kid's Prince and Ozzy records and substituting U2 and Phil Collins like the cassette Jeff Ling made for you says to do? Will that do anything to change the kid's taste besides making him even angrier at his parents? If I were a parent and my kid brought home something that I felt might be harmful to his emotional growth or whatever, like, say, Top Gun on video, or Sammy Hagar album, I wouldn't just hit the roof and grab the whole thing away. Would that teach the kid that what he bought might screw up his head? No. It would just reinforce the idea that daddy just doesn't understand and daddy's mean and daddy's a fascist. He took my record away. What I would do is sit down with the kid and say, okay, you went out and bought this thing. Why? Tell me why you like it. Tell me what you see in it. What does it mean to you? What do you think they're trying to say? And now I'll tell you why I don't like it. It seems to me, Mrs. Gore, that rational communication and discussion is a far healthier way to help nurture a loving family. Your letter claims you are not an uptight prude who wants to ban rock, yet you keep trying to restrict our music to your own idea of normal sex and sensuality. I was born in the USA too. I do not need a bouffant-encrusted thought police to tell me or any younger kids what they can listen to. Your fantasies of laws that wash our art out with soap would be a whole lot funnier if the PMRC had less money and power. I would urge cream readers, people who love music, and you to keep an eye out for censorship going on in your area. Who's trying to shut down the radio stations and why? And oftentimes it'll be one crank who will get the ear of the FCC or the college president. Nobody shows up to give the other side. Somebody has to show up. After all, which consumer revolt really has more numbers? People who don't like music or people who do? I mean, what would happen if a bunch of letters came into CBS and Warner Brothers saying, I won't buy records with a warning sticker on them? Also, you can go to various record stores saying, if you take certain records out, I will not buy anything else from your store ever again. At the very least, why give the PMRC sponsors your money? I know I won't be buying Coors beer for a long, long time. Don't have much desire to buy 7-Up or fly on American Airlines or put up with a bull from Merrill Lynch. And by the way, Mrs. Gore, I don't care if you use hairspray. The Constitution says you can do that, too.
There is a warning on the album cover explaining the foldout may be offensive to some people. Still, the Los Angeles city attorney says that's not enough.
I think that this is a cost-effective way of sending out the message to those people who wish to profiteer off the distribution of harmful matter to minors, that we're not going to look the other way and that we're going to prosecute.
Why I'm glad the space shuttle blew up. No! It wasn't the classroom full of school kids on TV, all whimpering in horror of what they'd seen on the screen. Each one of them still wearing one of those pointed birthday hats. No! Our first reaction at my house was each of us daring the other to call up the local San Francisco papers and say, oh, hi there. We're that legendary Libyan hit squad you've written so much about. And we blew up the space shuttle. Late that night, we gave up the idea. Same old excuse. What if we get caught? Sometimes, you know, it really does make sense just to chicken out. But now I find out we were pretty damn lucky. If the Challenger had made it home, things might now be much worse. Because NASA had this little plan for the following space shuttle they somehow forgot to tell us about. Got in the mail Xerox of a magazine called The Nation, and this later turned up in Common Cause, where they reported NASA had these plans to send the next scheduled shuttle into orbit carrying a payload of 46 pounds of plutonium. It only took a few specs to give Karen Silkwood those zits. 46 pounds of plutonium. If that one had blown up, there'd be enough radiation in the air to cause cancer in as many as 5 billion people. How reckless can you get? Up, up, and away! We'll just launch Star Wars the easy way. Fire it up into the great beyond and just don't tell anybody you put it there. After all, in America, when people don't know what hurts them, they don't care. Just blame the mysterious fallout cancer epidemic on Gaddafi! And think of all the money people we know and love would make selling how to cope with cancer kits to Rolling Stone readers and yuppies. That's why I'm glad the space shuttle blew up. Because if that next one had gone up, it might have blown up and melted all of us, too.
Malcolm McLaren once said, the purpose of pop culture is to soften the blow of daily life. You know, get everybody so caught up in falling in love as a carrot on a stick that they buy and they buy and they buy, and you can control them like rats in a maze, and they're more obedient shoppers and more easily used in the workforce. I mean, comic books. Who's your favorite cartoon character? The Freak Brothers? The Little Penguin in Bloom County? You know, the Doonesbury people, Bullwinkle, Yogi Bear, Nancy Reagan, Muammar Gaddafi, George Duke Majan. What are they? They're cartoon characters. They don't have any real power. Somebody pays to put them there and tells them what to do and hands them the right cue cards. You'll notice how one of America's best-loved stuffed animals, Ronald Reagan... Have you noticed how lost he is when he doesn't have his cue cards? But... I'm thankful in a way that the technocrats up there that love us so much, the people in the suits that play God, have put so much time and effort into creating so many cartoon characters to keep me entertained and amused. I try to explain this to people, but they say, no, man, that's a fact. I read it in the paper, man, it's a fact. It's got to be true. And these kind of papers, like the National Enquirer and the Weekly World News, for years they've outsold these supposed truthful papers. Solid proof that people believe what they want to believe. We all do. I mean, you'll notice the Enquirer is now speaking not of actors and actresses' names, but the characters they play on television, as though those characters are real. The New York Post always calls Reagan by his first name in their headlines. Ron thumps Democrats again. So if they're going to take all this time to give me all these great facts, I figured I should clip and save them for posterity and read them to you. So, how'd you like to be brainwashed with some truth and some facts? The way you make facts, you shake them up in this here Pan American Airlines barf bag. Take some raw information, pour it out on the table, and what do you have? Truth! least as it's presented to us by our fun-loving technocrats. So how about some truth, huh?
And what do you know? The first one on the pile says, nightly news programs today contain 25% fewer stories than they did just 6 years ago. Dateline Niles, Ohio. Fundamentalist minister Vernon Caton has denounced the Easter Bunny as a pagan god. And to prove his point, he has burned a giant effigy of a rabbit in the town square. Win a free night with me if you can get me a color picture of that incident for a record cover. Meanwhile, in Rome, a waiter named Antonio Ferranti has been arrested for including nude photos of himself in the menus he handed to restaurant patrons. Rolling Stone publisher Jan Wenner has put staff on notice that they may be tested for drugs. Oh, yes. True to form, former President Gerald Ford was recently spattered with eggs and snowballs by students at the University of Michigan. The students were actually aiming for Ed Meese. A part of the research undertaken by Ed Meese's Commission on Pornography, one of the commissioners wondered aloud, is it legal to have sex with a corpse if you're married to it? Guess what the ad campaign for Korean Airlines was right around the time that 747 got shot down over the Soviet Union? Korean Airlines. Our flights not only seem shorter, they are shorter. Half the scientists on Earth are known to be working on military projects. And you wonder why they don't find a cure for AIDS. They probably caused it, he says. Children between the ages of 10 and 15 can, this summer, attend Money Management Camp for Kids. Activities for your 10-year-old include understanding the stock market, bonds and mutual funds, and personal financial planning. And you wonder why all them gray-suited zombies never seem to have much of a sense of humor. A gang of bandits have been whizzing around West Germany, robbing banks, wearing masks of President Reagan and Frankenstein. Authorities said the silly-looking rogues made off with 133 grand and five stick-ups before being caught 3 years later. A Soviet submarine fired an intercontinental ballistic missile aimed at the Kamchatka Peninsula in Siberia, right near where they shot that plane down, but they hit China instead. The SSN-8 missile veered 30 degrees south of the targeted landing area and into Manchuria. The missile's self-destruct command wasn't working any better than its guidance system. The Pentagon called the mishap just a glitch. The sort of thing that could happen to anyone. The Navy lost track of almost $320 million in aviation spare parts aboard its aircraft carriers last year. Where are they now? And finally, Ronald Reagan once confided to none other than Barbara Walters that the movie that most impressed him when he was growing up was Frankenstein! Put that in your pipe and smoke it tonight. Ladies, gentlemen, and potato chip bags, good afternoon, and welcome to the Mild Kingdom, where each week we take you around the world for a close-up armchair look at the wild world of animals. We show you lions we borrowed from a zoo savagely stalk and attack their prey that we tied down ahead of time to ensure a good camera angle. We take you Disney style to the white wilderness of the far north. You are there when it's Jonestown season for nature's fascinating lemmings. The same ones we bought earlier from Eskimo children and transported 1,000 miles away so we could film their migration scene accurately on a revolving snow-covered turntable. But when we got them to the edge of the cliff, those lemmings wouldn't cooperate. So our crew just picked them up and threw them over the edge and into the river below.
Over they go, says the narrator, casting themselves bodily into space. The Arctic Sea is dotted with tiny, bobbing bodies.
Besides those endless insurance commercials, we have a special treat for you today here on the Mild Kingdom. A fantastic voyage deep into the heart of the jungles of darkest Lebanon, where our camera zeroes in on an innocent fawn out by the airport near Beirut. Hey! Yo! We're the United States Marines. Now, we know how you've all been killing each other for at least 2,000 years, but we're here now. So stop all this fighting, okay? And, you know, like magic, all your generations of hatred will simply go away. Dude. We're talking national security here. We're here to protect the family of Christian heroin warlords most friendly to the West. So, come on, knock off all this fighting and stuff, you hear? Or we'll tell Mom.
After a trash bag commercial, we take you to a cold gray hangar to watch our honest president pretend to mourn 200 brave young men who were shipped home from Beirut, gift wrapped in Hefty brand corpse bags, blown to bits by another goddamn truck bomb. But we knew they were sitting ducks. We sacrificed them Aztec style so we could use their dead meat as food for war fever right here at home. Tied them all down perfectly like prey for the lions from the zoo. Kaboom! Look who did it. Those dirty Arabs did it, man. Let's go get them. Let's go get them. Let's go get them. Fan the bonfires of racism. Get people hot and boiling for revenge in their living rooms. Then we can go play shoot 'em up anywhere we choose. Libya, Nicaragua. Now our backers can cash in without the public asking a lot of questions. Well, we've run out of time for this week. We hope you enjoyed our little adventure. We hope to brainwash you again soon with all the accuracy you've come to expect from life in the Mild Kingdom.
Good morning, this is Night Call and you're on the air.
I think they should have record labeling because I know kids do listen to that and take it very seriously.
Well, you know what Lenny Bruce said? He said that adults don't want kids to look at pornography because they're afraid they'll grow up and do the same thing.
Yeah. My mom's boyfriend's kids, they were into this devil stuff from listening to Ozzy Osbourne and Black Sabbath.
Yeah?
I grew up on Black Sabbath records, and I never got into the devil
stuff.
Well,
they were in this barn, and they were killing cats and writing all over the wall with it.
Do you really think that's a product of a record alone, or do you think it's a product of their surroundings?
This is the country, you know. These are supposed to be nice country kids, you know.
But,
well, the more you try to mold somebody into a nice country kid, the more there's going to be something boiling inside. I've known people who've done real ugly things to animals as well, and it had nothing to do with what they heard on a record album. Well, I don't think there's any songs on an Ozzy record or a Black Sabbath record that are ordering kids to go out and kill animals. I think it's something they do on their own because there's been a lot of other things going into their minds over the years. Television, for example, that desensitizes them to the pain of other living things.
More on our national mood. Dateline Wilmington, Delaware. Former Republican Governor Pierre Pete DuPont IV, yes, that DuPont, of Delaware announced his candidacy for the GOP presidential nomination and called for mandatory drug testing of the nation's teenagers, saying he would withhold federal aid from school districts who refused to go along. Go Petey. It amazes me what they can do in election season, especially when it comes to phony patriotism. Wave a flag and stomp Grenada and somehow we're strong and everything's cool. This is a reply to phony patriots called Stars and Stripes of Corruption. I'd like to close with this. Finally made it to Washington, D.C. in the middle of the night. Couldn't wait. I headed straight down to the Capitol Mall. My heart began to pound. There it is. It really exists. Up on the hill, the big tit, the Capitol building, a life-size reproduction of the American International Pictures logo. I had to touch it. I had to see if it was real. So I walked on up the hill, and for some weird reason, even I was thinking, hello, old friend. So I looked around a while, unzipped my pants, and pissed on the Capitol building when no one was looking. Then I turned around and looked down Capitol Hill, and across the Capitol Mall, porking the sky, was the ever-so-prick-like Washington Monument, with flags for pubic hair erected around the bottom. Two lights they have now near the top of the Washington Monument flash on and off every night like two red eyes of a giant Ku Klux Klansman with a pointed white hood on. The Washington Monument, the great eternal Klansman. You turn around almost anywhere in D.C., and the great eternal Klansman is there watching you. All those buildings from the history books lit up proudly in the night. Somehow it fit to see homeless people passed out on the lawn. So this is where it all happens. The power games and the bribes, the spooks, the arms dealers, the fat cats, the religious right, all playing tug of war for that one piece of ass of the Stars and Stripes of Corruption. Times like that, I feel ashamed to be an American. Here we are, too stuck up to learn from our mistakes. Here we are, trying to start another Vietnam. Here we are, fiddling while Rome burns at home. Here we are, strip mining the world like it's our big slave plantation, all for office building barons who just hoard the loot themselves. Maybe occasionally they'll throw us a crumb, but most of the time they just say, sorry, you're laid off. We can't use you anymore. Soup is good food, and we bought a sweatshop in Taiwan who will do your job for cheap. But don't blame us now. Blame the Japanese. Meanwhile, haven't you heard? Over the speakers, on the screen, America's back! Yeah, America's back! At the game, it plays the worst. America's back is up against the wall we built. Scared shitless of the fact that even number one must someday grow up and learn to share. And you wonder why people in other countries hate us so much. wouldn't by any chance be the Shahs and the dictators and the death squads and the Hitlers we handpick to do our dirty work and bleed their own people dry for our evil empire? How do we face ourselves in the morning? Simple! We let ourselves be drugged from above. Shoot up with God and country with a bang. America rules. Let's go to war. Don't have to be for freedom anymore. It's business scams that we'll die for. Who needs commies for an enemy when we're so eager to destroy ourselves with civil rights? Who cares? When do I get paid? This me generation doesn't care if life's a lie. We crave being used. We're proud to enforce the stars and stripes of corruption. Patriots. Who are the real patriots? The Archie Bunker slobs waving the flags? Or the people with the guts to work for some real change? Rednecks and bombs, they don't make us strong when we ain't even figured out how to feed ourselves. A real test of strength is caring, not the war toys our bribe-snorting generals sell the world. Stars and stripes blight the sky like one big sour mirage, twisting in the wind like a dream gone wrong. Yet here we sit like Linus in the Peanuts cartoon, just sucking our thumbs with Old Glory and what we think it represents for our security blanket. Sucking our thumbs to the tune of America, love it or leave it. Beat the shit out of people who care enough to criticize it. Starts to look a little more like Chile in our high-strung redneck land. You people really want a banana republic that bad? Why don't you go move to one? Better yet, why not just tear off this red, white, and blue blindfold and stamp it out in the cement like the cold, stale cigarette it is? People hide behind a flag because freedom is too scary. Real freedom means we gotta take care of each other so we don't need all these cops and all these laws to do it for us. Larry Flint knew enough to use Old Glory as a diaper, but when will we rise above the need for babysitters like the stars and stripes of corruption? Meanwhile, back at the gates of the ranch we're still locked out of, what can just one of us do against all that money and all that power that just crushes us down like the little insects we're all too happy to become? Do we have to spend our lives under someone's big magnifying glass, getting burned all full of holes like another dried old leaf, only to be blown away in the wind? Rise up! But how? Most leaders just want sheep. We won't destroy society in a day until we change ourselves first, from the inside out. We can start by not lying so much and treating other people like dirt. We don't have to base our happiness on how much we can scam. Winning isn't everything, it's the only thing. Winning through intimidation, looking out for number one, me, 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 me. Feels so much better just to lift that whole monkey off our backs and say, goodbye, food chain. I can survive without being owned. I am a person, not a pet for the stars and stripes of corruption. And I'm thankful I can still say things like this without being taken out and shot. And that's why I'm on guard against these goons who keep on trying to take our rights away. My ancestors weren't born here either, but it's the only country I got. So I guess real love means trying to help save each other from ourselves. It's school. We could teach kids communication. Instead of pushing winning as the only thing, get rid of PE and organized sports so the money could be used for more theater and art. They want physical education. Wouldn't it be cool if we all learned massage techniques while we were in school? Yeah. Want to balance the budget? Tax the churches. Cut down on crime? We could legalize some drugs to bypass the mob so the price goes down. Maybe we should try learning from the mistakes of the past instead of being so easily led to repeat them. No one's going to come off the screen and do it for us. We will just have to fix ourselves. And if we can't do better than this, you tell me who will. Honesty ain't all that hard. Just put Rambo back in your pants and look around. We're all people. Who needs countries anyway? So, Mr. Love It or Leave It, thank you for the toilet paper, but your flag don't mean shit to me. Our land, I love it too. I think I love it more than you. Enough to take so-called patriotism back from those gunsuckers off on the right and put it back where it belongs with the people who fight the stars and stripes of corruption. Let's bring it all down. Good night.
Vietnam never happened! Vietnam never happened. Amusement park is now pulled over our eyes with fun for the entire family. Thrill to Buddhist priests who set themselves on fire at noon. Be a part of the action at Kent State and show those demonstrators who's boss in our revolving Dirty Harry go-round. Then it's on to the defense industry kickback bumper cars. Go ahead, blow them up! We'll just replace them at 20 times the price. Then unwind with your favorite hard drugs in our fabulous indoor shooting gallery.
Who's that knocking outside? Is it the cops or is it Memorex?
Play miniature golf with live grenades. Our Peace with Honor roller coaster will destroy you in order to save you. The kids, they'll love our petting zoo, where you can feed overpriced McDonaldland cookies to our pen full of children deformed by Agent Orange. Then, if you're really brave, how about the haunted house of Frank Nugenhand in the Sky of Siam, where you'll feel what it's like as you're sealed in a warm body bag while CIA operatives slit your stomach open to stuff you full of heroin baggies to send home to mother. Is that getting a bit much? Just go quietly where we want you, to our video arcade. When you come out 3 days later, pick a prize from the pet shop, a mixed blood orphan left behind by some fun-loving Yankee soldier. Consolation prize, a year's supply of blank draft notices. Just fill in the names of your friends and your enemies and give them their surprise of their life by mail. They'll go quietly. You'll see. Vietnam never happened. What Reagan didn't know. Iran. Iran Gate. Contra Gate. North Scam. Iranamuck. Here we go again with the best present we've received in a long, long time. Your friend and mine, Grandpa Caligula, the Gipper. Boy, is he shitting Teflon bricks now. The great communicator now calls reporters sons of bitches. Caught with his greedy, scaly hands in the genocide cookie jar. Hiding arms deals from his own army. Relying on a compulsive liar, a five-star colonel, to make secret foreign policy in his cubicle in the White House basement. The moral equivalent of our founding fathers,
the Contras, got their cash to go around killing doctors, teachers, women, children from mafia-style Swiss bank accounts and less widely reported cocaine deals. Can you imagine the look on poor Nancy's face if they proved that Ronnie's so-called freedom fighters were the ones bringing in those drugs for our children? This is the greatest soap opera going. Not even Get Smart has so many hilarious surprises. Speaking of Get Smart, have you noticed how much Maxwell Smart looks like Robert McFarlane? And isn't George Schultz a little too perfect in his role as the chief? Moaning at his desk, one disaster after another created by his finest secret agents. Oh, Mac, now look what you've done. You can't die from ODing on Valium. That darn fool kid. Reagan Duffy, the flaky fanatic, the only wheeler dealer in the whole Mideastern poker game who is so bad, he makes Jimmy Carter look like he knew what he was doing. We will never give in to terrorists. We will never pay ransom for hostages. Oh no, not us. Keep in mind, he could have had all those hostages back for a cool million. But what does he do? He gives the Ayatollah, of all people, 30 million, and in exchange, he doesn't get the hostages back, not all of them. What a genius! What a deal! What a guy! Don't you wish you had him on your side, doing his best on your behalf? Don't you wish you had him to depend on next time you get caught in a small emergency like being kidnapped? And what does he do when his B-movie game is up? He freaks out and stonewalls, just like Nixon. No surprise, really, when you look around and see how many seasoned Watergate criminals have been up to their old tricks since Reagan gave them their new jobs in the White House and in his cabinet. Just like Nixon, he blames it all on the press. Somehow it's the fault of the media that his pet terrorists got caught. Sure, he says mistakes were made, but he has yet to say he was sorry. He says, I know my people did nothing wrong, even though I didn't know what they'd been up to. It was all done behind my back. It was all done behind my ever so willing asshole. Honest, I didn't know. Would I lie to you? Maybe. Maybe he really didn't know. It wouldn't be the first time he didn't know the obvious, now would it? Who says the great communicator ever once bothered to proofread his own script? He almost so much as admits he doesn't care. For a president of the United States, it's amazing all the things over the years he didn't know. It's almost as if he grew up watching television. For example, how many of you know that there is a token black person in Reagan's cabinet? HUD Secretary Samuel Pierce. He's been there ever since the beginning, but you just never hear about him, do you? Apparently, Reagan didn't know about him either. When he ran into him 6 months after Pierce started on the job at a meeting of big city mayors and said, "How are you, Mr. Mayor? I'm glad to meet you. How are things in your city?" When he was visiting Brazil, he didn't know what country he was in and called for a toast to the people of Bolivia. He then quickly covered for himself by saying, oh, Bolivia was the next stop on his Latin American trip, but he was actually going to Colombia and wasn't scheduled to visit Bolivia at all. When he was in Oklahoma campaigning for the re-election of Senator Don Nichols, he urged everyone out there to be sure and go vote for Don Rickles. What he didn't know about South Africa, his definition of apartheid live on national radio was that South Africans have eliminated the segregation we once had in our own country. Last time he unveiled his budget, he said we will be spending more money than ever before to combat the use of drugs. What he didn't know was his own budget called for less. What he didn't know about the Jews in Nazi Germany when he said, after visiting Bitburg and the cemetery with all them stormtrooper skeletons down below, you know, he said that Nazi soldiers were victims just as surely as the victims in the concentration camps. Some people got a little bit unamused. So he said, oh yes, I know all the bad things that happened in that war. I was in uniform for 4 years myself. What he didn't know was World War II took place in Europe and in the South Pacific, not in the first motion picture unit of the Army Air Corps at Hal Roach Studios in Hollywood. He said missiles launched from submarines can be recalled in event that it's a false alarm for nuclear war. What he didn't know is they can't be recalled. When asked if he'd be visiting the Vietnam War Memorial, he said, I can't tell until somebody tells me. I never know where I'm going. So, the question remains, is our buddy Ronald McGregan really in the dark? Really just an absent-minded bozo along for the ride? Or does his real evil lie elsewhere? Is this talking Gila monster with a pompadour so conniving that he knows his real role and purpose as an actor and plays it anyway? Just smile. Read the cue cards, Ronnie. Now talk assuredly and soothe the people. It's your job to soften the blow of corporate martial law. Get them to like the taste of high-tech feudalism that the powers behind the scenes who pull your strings have in mind. People unemployed and starving? Just tell them how we whooped them in Grenada. Tell them the one about the welfare mother who spent her food stamps on vodka. When someone cries atrocities, just smile and say, I'm a Contra too. And somehow, that'll make the atrocities okay. Just wait and see. They'll believe it. Because corporate martial law must come so quietly in this country that people won't even smell it. Watergate was sloppy. A Marcos-style coming to visit and deciding to stay wouldn't quite work here. This clampdown must be eased in slowly over 30 or 40 years, so hardly anyone will notice what's going on as our rights are being systematically whittled away. At least not lift an eyebrow as long as the price is right. And the last 5 or 10 years of the onset of corporate martial law won't be quite so difficult with the right actor in the right place, playing the right role for the fans. The chipper grandfather we all kind of wish we had. Grandpa Caligula. See him smile and wave as he trots off with Nancy for another holiday at the ranch. Now, if he really didn't know about all his elves playing Rambo that are still getting away with murder, check this out. There's a book out now called Dark Victory, Reagan, MCA, and the Mob, published by Viking Press. Its author is Don Moldea. where it is written. In the 1950s, MCA made this little deal with the Screen Actors Guild, that's the actors union, an exclusive, what they called a blanket waiver, that would make MCA billions of dollars. It was rigged so only MCA could act as agent to its own stars. MCA alone was somehow exempt from a coming actors strike. And at that time, the president of the Screen Actors Guild was guess who? Ronald Reagan. He made the deal. His reward from MCA as his career began to peter out was to be named host of the long-running GE Television Theater. Then later on, MCA gave him 25% of the whole program, and overnight he was on his way to being a multimillionaire. Then, in 1962, a grand jury called in Ronald McRagan, wanted to have a few words with Ronald McRagan, asked him if these deals he made, weren't they a little corrupt? And Reagan, professional actor, suddenly acted confused and replied almost as if on cue, clear back in 62, that he, the president of the Screen Actors Guild, didn't know what was going on. Sound familiar? Another commercial I found a while back, first on an airline flight magazine, then in the San Francisco Chronicle, and now they're running this ad in places like travel magazines that kids aren't likely to leaf through, like Sunset or something like that. What we have here is kind of a Maria McKee look-alike with shorter hair that's appropriately mussed up for MTV. We have a old high school letter jacket on, and she has an angry look on her face. Facially, she kind of looks like she might be 28, 30 years old, had her jaw fixed and a nose job to look like Margot Hemingway. And it says above the model, Julie's 14 and headed nowhere. What's next? Julie is 14, unmotivated, angry, and rebellious. She is failing in school and associating with undesirable friends. She is unresponsive to parental guidance. They don't know where to turn for help. If you have a daughter like Julie, there is an answer. The parents of girls and boys with difficult problems need special help. The Heritage School in Provo, Utah will deal with manipulation, teach responsibility, motivate, and change rebellious behavior. They even have an 800 number to prove it. There's several of these schools kicking around all over. There's Baptist Bible camps in the south down lonely roads, so nobody ever looks what's going on there. One person I know, he was kidnapped by two plainclothes people from a BART rapid transit train station and put on a commercial airliner and taken to Utah. He wasn't released for 2 years. He also told me that some of the other people there had been sent from places like Beverly Hills, and their crime was bad grades. This is for him, and it's called May All Your Dreams Be Wonderful. Something's wrong with you. You hate us. You're so mixed up and weird. A danky old maid on Phil Donahue confirmed our fears. It's that devil rock music you and your friends listen to. She says a drug-happy shrink or military school will fix you. Our dime store books on problem families say it's true. You say you want respect. What you need is discipline. First, we got the punk and heavy metal handbook from the Back and Control Training Center in Fullerton. We learned what you were up to. We learned you could be a hardcore punk, a skinhead punk, a skate punk, a peace punk, a suicidal punk, an occult punk, or a pop punk, or a weirdo. And we learned signs of occult behavior include black t-shirts. That Raiders jersey has to go. Those high-top tennis shoes you wear at basketball practice, those too. Get them out of here. It says so. Right in this well-researched manual put together by two probation officers in Orange County for Back and Control Training Center. This is real. This thing is real, and judges force kids to go here. We know about occult animals and colors. They list here cat, donkey, eagle, our national symbol, frog. Turn off the Muppet Show right now. Silver is the occult metal. That's why we eat with plastic picnic forks now. So, we're following their rules to de-punk and de-metal in the family. Do not dress in any style that represents punk or heavy metal. Do not wear hair dyed or cut in any style that represents punk rock or heavy metal. Do not associate with punk rockers. Do not wear punk or rock or heavy metal accessories. Obtain permission to be out of the home and keep parents informed of whereabouts at all times. It says here, if you don't go to class, we'll just follow you to class. Do not wear your hair in any fashion that will be disruptive to fellow classmates. Do not wear any jewelry that could cause disturbance or conflict among students. Signs of occult graffiti. Occult graffiti, this is a quote now, is frequently placed underground, under bridges, in flood control channels, and under freeway overpasses. Why? To be closer to hell and the devil. If you can't afford a ladder when you go spray painting at age 16, it's the devil's fault. Just ask the experts. Ask the experts. Among the symbols of the occult, they have, of course, the Aussie logo. They have a peace symbol. We say bring back the peace symbol, but the experts here say it's a broken cross upside down with arms broken to mock Christianity. Another occult symbol they list here is the Jewish Star of David. Yes. Yeah, yes way. There it is, right there in the manual. And below that, you ever see Wide World of Sports Absurdities where they have University of Texas against the Arkansas Razorbacks with all their fans with their how about them hog shirts and stuff? You notice the Texas fans all go hook 'em horns. Horns of the devil. Two fingers up is a denial of the Trinity. Three fingers down with gesture means 666. May all your dreams be wonderful, Act Two. You say you want respect. What you need is discipline. So we're shipping you off to a private barbed wire reform school that's exempt from prison regulations because it masquerades as an educational concentration camp. 20 grand a year is a small price to pay to avoid talking straight with our kids. May all your dreams be wonderful at prison camp, honey dear. We're destroying you just to save you, so you'll even like living here. Once the beaver, always the beaver. And don't forget to write. Welcome to Provo Canyon, you little asshole. We're going to be seeing a lot of each other. Now, go to that room where these big dudes are and put on these orange pajamas right now. And then sit still and be totally silent and do that every day for one whole week.
while the big dudes stand and watch you. Submit and behave, and then you can move on to your hours. 250 hours standing perfectly still, silently in our pale white room, or else. One wrong move, and it's the lie detector again. And another trip to solitary in our 4x4x4 foot cell. The only TV you get here, Jack, is church programs on Sunday. We won't even let you think what you want. We won't even let you think what you want. May all your dreams be wonderful, Act 3. See that cute, darling kid in the third grade picture? That's our child. That's what he'll be like when he comes home from reform school. Rewired and cured. I'll bet he'll finally learn to get his own Pepsi. Once the beaver, always the beaver. 20 grand a year is a small price to pay to avoid talking straight with our kids. And now, you've come home calm as a zombie. A model student in school. You've learned to like desks and let us pick your friends. Your old pals say you've come back home a broken shell. But you'll thank us for all this one day. We know. Bet you'll send your own kids there when they steal your favorite handgun. We're so glad you're not a person anymore, just a good citizen. We like you better as our rugby shirt pet. We like you better when you're easy to use. Once the beaver, always the beaver. 20 grand a year is a small price to pay to avoid talking straight with our kids.
Bud Owens.
Thank you very much, Ron. Good morning to you, gentlemen. I'm not being impertinent or disrespectful, but I do have a question for your guest, and I'm terribly shocked that he's given so much airtime for this. Has he ever had a psychiatric evaluation?
My father was a psychiatric social worker for several years, so in some ways he got to know me very well. In other ways, it was a classic example of parent and child lack of communication.
Mm-hmm. Well, that would certainly create a problem in a young mind for sure, especially if nothing was ever done about it in the later years.
Let me ask, define a problem in a young mind, and what gives you the right to mess with other people's heads?
Well, you're doing exactly the same thing, only in a much more deleterious fashion, because your exposure is worldwide, countrywide, if not international. And I think it is dreadful. I know we can switch around all kinds of statistics to our own convenience, but I do know for a fact, and you probably are aware of this fact also, that there are over 1 million young girls that are pregnant and unmarried in this country every year, not just once in a while.
And what on earth does that have to do with our music? We aren't promoting sexism. We aren't degrading either sex.
On an album that you stated earlier in the program, stating that there were 10 different sexual positions on your album.
I didn't say that.
No, that's what the L.A. city attorney said.
Well, then, I'm sorry, but at least it has been stated. I'm not imagining things.
Oh, yes, you are. You're assuming I'm guilty until proven innocent, which is the exact opposite of what the Constitution says.
That's quite right, and I'll certainly concur with you on that, but I also am in that same predicament. I was diagnosed manic depressive 6 years ago, and that is the label that is not on my forehead, nor is it tattooed anywhere on my body. But it somehow or other is either indicative in my behavior or whatever, but that has been held against me, plus the fact I was born way back in 1920.
Dateline Dallas. A home drug testing kit, soon to be on the market, costing $24.95, will allow parents to check up on their children and seeing if they've been using any pot, cocaine, angel dust, or Valium. The product, called Aware, includes a
plastic specimen bottle, disclosure form, and a mailing label. Now, if you can somehow pull your kid's pants down and get them to pee in a jar without being hauled in for child abuse, you can then mail the urine sample to the American Institute for Drug Detection. And they'll mail back the test results 10 days later, guaranteed. The company says they hope to sell 100,000 of the drug testing kits in the first year and plan to place ads in magazines that cater to women with children. Quote, "We're going to take it to drug and grocery store chains. We hope it will be put in their health and beauty aids section." So here we go again, don't we? Yet another round of dun dun dun, the drug crisis. Dun da da, dun da 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 da. Dun da da, dun da 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 da. Dead basketball stars. Da 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 da. Mike Hammer in the slammer. Da 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 da. Everywhere you look. Da 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 da. It's drugs! One of those carefully planned, ever handy smoke screens of hysteria only an economic crisis or an election year could love. Forget the economy and who's looting us and why. Drugs! Forget the next Vietnam splashed in front of our noses like a splatter movie by the CIA's death squad buddies in Nicaragua. Drugs! Teen suicide? That's already dead. This season's ready-to-wear paranoia scam, sure enough, is...
drugs!
Last year, it was terrorism. Remember terrorism.
Don't go into the woods, Little Red Riding Hood. You might meet a terrorist. They're everywhere. I know. I can feel it. Can't you?
That was last spring. But now we're moving right back once again to...
drugs!
They're creeping through the walls of your homes. Drugs are all Nancy Reagan talks about when she gets a little tipsy at those she Washington parties. The clouds are on. School bus drivers are on. God is on. Even narcs are on. Call the Army. Call the Navy. Call Tom Cruise and Sylvester Stallone. We must protect our borders. Drug abuse is on the rise, even though when you actually look at the statistics, they say that it is not. But how else could you get people to piss in a jar without anybody even asking if their rights are being molested? Are there any seniors here tonight? Any of you run into any of them recruiters from corporations who come onto campus and... come work for us. Ask them if they'll make you pee in a jar. And if they say yes, you can just say no. Wake up! We're talking violation here. 1984 has come to mean your piss is our business. Who cares if the over-the-counter drugs you're taking for nerves because you're so afraid of having to pee in a jar in front of the boss winds up testing positive for heroin in some freaky mail-away lab down in Texas? Either way, you know what's coming next.
Mr. Vader would like to see you in his office.
The computer says you're a junkie. You're fired. Go away.
Imagine having that hanging over you like a cloud through your entire working life. What better way than through that kind of fear to finally break the workforce of this liberal illusion that they're somehow entitled to dignity and rights? Why are we putting up with all this? Maybe it's safe if you're still in school, but as the old saying goes, if you like school, you'll love work. Why are we putting up with all this? We're just dropping our pants and letting it happen. Nothing I can do about it. Looks like I have no choice. I'll get used to it after a while, I guess. Kind of like getting used to death camps in Nazi Germany. You know, just hold your nose while they barbecue the bodies, go rent a few videos for the night, and everything will be okay as long as it doesn't happen to you. But here, a little drug scare hype is all it takes to make us like it. Your sports heroes do it. You can too. Luckily, there are a few people out there in the wilderness who are just saying no to this Rehnquist wet dream. Pouring Drano in their urine samples. Substituting someone else's carefully clean specimen for their own just to sabotage their own test results. Personnel managers are disappointed. Tisk, tisk. You can tell where this is going, right? This latest crackdown on what's left of our right to privacy is enough to make old-fashioned human rights junkies like me piss in their pants, right? Wrong! Your analysis is freedom! Because I've found a way to cash in. I don't drink too often. For the most part, these drugs bore me. And I was brought up, like the rest of us, to believe in the land of opportunity. So I got to thinking, yeah, my PP is worth more than gold. From now on, when my bladder alarm starts to tinkle, I'll be ready to capture every last drop. No self-storage space is big enough for me. And when I'm ready to deal from a position of strength, I'm gonna pull up in a black van right in front of the big old bank downtown. Slide the side door partway open. Hey, you, come here, come here. I know my prey. They need me. I'm just providing a service, right? And if I don't, someone else will. Come here, come here, come here, you. See what I got in my hand? I got a whole truckload of crack-sized vials of guaranteed drug-free wee-wee. Not so fast, brother. I want $50 a pop, and you know you're gonna give it to me. After all, it's only your job. In no time, I'll have enough to bribe any judge in New Jersey I want. 2 Swiss bank accounts in every one of my garages, built not from cocaine, but from cocaine hysteria. And I'll still have enough time to use my Swiss bank accounts to launder more blood money for the Contras. After all, every kind of prohibition just creates another underworld. And this time, that underworld just happens to be me. But if we're all gonna squat down and piss on demand for Big Brother, let's at least play fair, okay? In Japan, you can now buy a drug, I think it's called or pronounced perfusamine, a simple over-the-counter test designed to show if someone you know is going senile. Now, if Reagan, George Shultz, George Bush, and let's not forget that late, lamented, yowling potato chip of a CIA director we had, the one who distinguished himself by falling asleep at strategy meetings, but still had time to slip those murder manuals to the Contras, if they'd agree to take this senility test once a week on primetime TV, let Vanna turn the letterings, yes or no, maybe the rest of us could finally get some sleep.
Names for bands. Every once in a while, somebody will come up to me and ask me to come up with a name for their band. I'm tired of all those other names. Think of something good. You'd expect the band to want to take care of that, right? But oh no, not in a society where we're brought up to aspire to be spectators by our media and by our school system. Still, I try in good faith, but almost every damn time I keep drawing a blank. So, now I write them down. And after all, it's a great way to meet people when you're new in town, kind of like carrying extra matches or cigarettes for people to bum. Yo, got a pen I can borrow? Hell, carry 20. Me? I carry band names. And people need them, too. How many times have you heard the same old cliche band names over and over and over again? Something new?
Oh no, that's too hard. That's too difficult. Our friends might not like us. We might not get on a major label or college radio or MTV.
No, pick a formula. Any formula. The Lone Cowboys. Leather Wolf. Night Ranger. Psychofunkapus. And let's not forget those generic bands that sometimes give hardcore punk a bad name. Granted, my favorite example is broken up now, but they'll live on forever in the X's on the hands and t-shirt and colored vinyl as investment merchandising. Yes, there really was a band that once that could not think of anything better to call themselves than Youth of Today. Before that, we had Angry Youth, Bored Suburban Youth, White Suburban Youth, Youth Army, Wasted Youth. Bob Mould, when he was in Husker Du, suggested Young Youth. And I told some of my friends at Maximum Rock and Roll, hey, you guys have been reviewing records for years and telling people how to act when they go on the road, but some of you have never actually done it. Why not do your own band? It would be great. Old Youth. And we've had Dead Youth, Generic Youth, we could have Senile Youth. Somebody, one of these other shows, suggested Redundant Youth. I mean, the first step to a really good band name is to start with a good concept. So, picture this one for heavy metal. Granted, it's the most conservative and uniform of all loud rock music. No gym teacher could get so many people to dress alike. But even in metal, there's still room for a good concept. Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready to rock? Would you please welcome, live from Global Corporate Headquarters, this week's heavy metal sensation, Mondale! Picture it! Flashing on and off, 20 feet tall, and gleaming silvery gothic lettering that they all use now. Mondale, Mondale, Mondale. In a great big arena, just swarming with all them zombie-like fans, flicking the bics and lighting the matches, and shaking their fists in obedience to their fearless leader, just like people sig-heiling Hitler in the Nazi propaganda films. Spot the difference. While these five Walter Mondales are up there kicking ass on the stage, each wrapped in blue business suits, bullet belts, Viking helmets, maybe a flaming tie for the singer or a paste-on Frank Frazetta mustache, Mondale! He would have made a great heavy metal hero.
Everybody sing along with me one time. Lane Kirkland rules me. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Half the guys in Deep Purple look just like Walter Mondale now. But maybe that's too easy an example. Maybe that's old hat. You shouldn't kick a dinosaur when they're down to their last million, after all. But those people up in the office buildings who wear the satin baseball jackets, you know, the geeks up in New York and Century City and Hollywood and stuff, who never go to local shows but always know at their major label desk jobs that they know what kids want. Well, they know what kids want is speed metal, thrash metal, and the cartoon factor goes up accordingly, doesn't it? In one corner of the ring, you've got the good citizen upstanding metal bands like Stryper throwing Bibles out to the crowd, and oh, aren't their Farrah Fawcett wigs as fluffy as Charlie's Angels themselves? With eye makeup to match. While in the other corner of the ring, the evil, dark, death metal bands who sing about Satan and horns and tails and the dark side, like Slayer. Yeah! And 10,000 other bands that sound exactly like Slayer. It's all going to be blown away by the desert storm of Islamic speed metal. Picture Islamic speed metal. Call the band Magnum Jihad. And have the band members come out in black leather turbans with spikes and gas masks and Darth Vader robes, and women couldn't come to the show till they had their monogrammed Magnum Jihad veil from the merchandise booth. And all you'd need for lyrics would be some of those real subtle and tasty quotes from Saddam Hussein or Ayatollah Khomeini or Gaddafi, like, all Western countries are bad. Nothing but evil comes from them. Or to speed it up for the anthrax crowd, Islamic laws come from God, and therefore are good for everybody. Islamic laws come from God, and therefore are good for everybody. And with every other 70s dinosaur becoming cool again for all the wrong reasons, think of the comeback possibilities for Cat Stevens. He could either go the Magnum Jihad route with a nice fuzzed out cover of Climb on the Peace Train, Climb on the Peace Train, or just keep his old sound and If someone defames the prophet, he must die. Islamic speed metal, Magnum Jihad, coming soon on Great Satan Records. Or when you become a little more adult, you're expected to reach for one of those new age audio sedatives with a mellow sunset on the cover and the mandatory computer graphic typeset from high up on Windham Hill. Or if you prefer a Roger Dean Fantasy poo painting with twirly progressive rock lettering at the top, either way, mellow out with the good vibes of Earth Fart. Or just when you thought it was safe to go back in the water, Leonard Skinnerd has reformed. And, of course, those same geeks at the major labels in the satin baseball jackets up in the high office buildings are going, yeah, we've been waiting for this one for a while. Now that even the underground bands are playing a lot of 70s cock rock and sucking up to major labels and everything, this is going to be easy to put over on them this time. Southern rock is back. Southern rock is back.
got your beer bellies, got your pickup trucks, got your tractor tires, got your 3-4 guitar players, 4-5 drummers, got your rifle racks, got your Confederate flags, got your racism pork barrel. Or imagine all the images you could drill in your fans' minds if you called your band The Dentists. Or, ready? Electric meat. Pink meat. Anchovy smegma. Terrorists for peace. Black lung. Zion popsicle. My sweet slaughterhouse. Or pets eat their master. Or how about tailor-made for the cover of Spin and MTV, hunk. Tits, ass, and money. The absentee thought lords. Criminal spa. War cookies. Republican buttocks. Shut up and buy. Frankenchrist. Peeping Tom Collins. Chocolate fetus. Great wall of goat urine. Tumor circus. Mosquito cleavage. Chris masturbation. Uranium playpen. King pork. Madonna death cult. Peppermint leprosy. Angel pus, or the magic truncheons. The lone derangers. 3-mile colostomy. The gingerbread werewolves. Satan's buttermilk. Air guitar. The janitors of anarchy. Lost orgasm. Root canal. Be my urinal. Bark on cue. The crotch puppets. Magnum Dada. God. Conform or die. Fun with treason. You're fired. Video sex pope. Al Sharpton's hair. Cancer cures everything. South Africa. This still gets them every time. John Wayne on acid. Rogue boner. Radio free pig vomit. Or the Ku Klux Flintstones. Elvis Rehnquist. Crushed velvet vivisection. Dracula was gay. Witch penis. The Manson Surfers. Bank of Sodom. Keystone Stormtroopers. Sausage gone wrong. For the Nazi skinheads, Aryan embarrassment. Or for people whose idea of a full life is to drink up and boogie down, Frankie goes to the bathroom. The Doomsday Pop-Tarts. Autistic Chainsaw. Bono's Charred Remains. Sell Your Mom. Pneumonia Wranglers. Helter Syringe. This list could go on all night. So why be the 35th band in a row to call yourselves Bad Attitude? Vengeance, or the LA Guns, when you could storm the globe as the Imperial Turdsicles. Conquer MTV with Primer Gray Erection. Or coming soon to the Ritz, exclusive engagement, or they might not get to play, direct from New York, direct from England, please welcome Failure. Or coming soon to the Great Big Basketball Arena, tickets $20 in advance, $120 at the door, Fraud. And if you really want to get under people's skin and make them think, forget dead Kennedys. That's already been done. But you can take a grainy photo of your friend and mine, Mr. Patriotic Freedom Fighter himself, George Herbert Walker Bush, and put that on the front cover of the album. You know, tilted slightly at an angle with that grin of his leering out. And title this record, Lest We Forget. Then hit him where it counts. Top it all off with the name of the band, Lest We Forget by 6 Million Jews.